She says the ability to recognize one's own talent and endeavor to make it your life's purpose to light it and keep it burning despite any and every resistance is the mark of a true trailblazer. So the lady I'm going to introduce you to today is the one who's created this quote and truly lives by it. Jani, welcome to Zee Connect. It's such a pleasure to be talking to you today.
Thank you, Priya. The pleasure is all mine. It's lovely to have you here with me today.
Thank you so much. So before we go into your passion of art and painting and the charity work that you do, which I'm sure our viewers are going to be super inspired by the end of this segment, I want to know a little about your life. Where do you hail from and a little about your childhood?
Yes, I hail from a typical South Indian Brahmin family. And my father was an educationist. Somewhere in his, you know, early years of his career, he got posted to Kabul, Afghanistan, by the government of India. And I came back to India for my graduation in Pune, actually, Ferguson College. Then left it, went to join my dad again. I was like his tail wherever he went. I joined him. He was in Indonesia at the time. And then, of course, I started working for a marketing company and then went on to Amsterdam and then the Middle East now. So, yes, different cultures, different people. The core is all the same.
Yeah. All right. So moving on to your passion, which is painting. And right from the time I walked into the house, I've seen these beautiful paintings around me, with so many vibrant colors all across. Tell me, how did this passion of painting begin?
So I have my first tryst with painting started how old was I? Maybe 9 or 10, something like that. Proper with colors, you know. I was in Kabul at the time, and a lot of my friends, we were at home, you know, for want of something to do. My parents had gone out, and I had 3 of my Afghan friends with me, and we had colors because, you know, we had these small little Chinese bottles of oil colors, and we had no idea what to do with it. And there were no brushes because, you know, those days brushes were in such short supply, and we weren't so wealthy to, you know, buy proper art material. So we took the butter knife from the kitchen and we started painting with it on cardboard. And we were very thrilled with the effect, you know. So this is how I would say it started.
Jani, you'll be exhibiting your collection of beautiful paintings, as I see here, at the World Art Dubai, which is happening soon. Tell us a bit about what kind of collection can we expect to see there.
Okay, I do mostly contemporary impressionistic pieces. Okay, those are big words there, but I do, most of my art, as you see, Priya, is very bright. It's colorful, it's impressionistic. There is no defined details, but I paint with a palette knife, and whatever, you know, feeling I have is expressed through my art at that point of time in my life. So most of my pieces are huge pieces. They're like 100 by 150 or 100 by 120. I do small pieces as well, like the one behind you, 70 by 30. That one was inspired by Afghanistan, actually. It's the fall time in Afghanistan as a little girl. When I was there, I remember, you know, the park being so beautiful with orange leaves.
Now, like you were saying, a South Indian family, and there's been so much of, you know, literature, reading and education, so much of focus on it, which now makes me talk about the work that you do to make a difference in people's lives. A lot of charity work that you do in terms of funding education of medical students in Kenya with your foundation, Healing Lives. Tell us more about that.
About healing lives. Okay. Now that is a subject which is very, very close to my heart. Healing Lives, to answer your question, Healing Lives is not an NGO or a multi-global foundation, or, you know, it doesn't have an infrastructure like most of these established NGOs have. It is a culmination of like-minded souls. It's a family organization, and we all strongly believe in our family who have started this, that it is important, it's imperative for us to give the youth of this generation, the young adults of this generation, the one weapon that is really important to them, and that is the weapon of education, the weapon of literacy, because it is only this that can help them, you know, elevate them or uplift them from the abyss of poverty and desperation that they are there now. And what we do is we don't just fund primary or secondary education, because I'm sure there are a lot of people who will come and teach the kids ABC and how to read and write, and you know, a few others will come and give them clothes and food. We're interested in the kids who have passed all these stages, who have the grit and the determination to go beyond what they have been dealt with in life, right. You know,
well, already at a stage, yes, where they have, you know, where they have decided where they want to go,
yes,
and just need help, yes, need some aid in reaching
their,
that,
yes,
aim.
These kids are brilliant. They go for the medical entrance exams, and then their communities are fantastic as well. And to give the deposit to you know, get the admission, they pass the exams with high grades, by the way. And they borrow money. I mean, the community donates, you know, each one, the neighbor donates, the uncle donates, the great grand aunt donates, like $5, $10, whatever they can. And then they manage to collect $250 or $300 or $500 and they give it. They attend the class. The first 6 months is okay, because the university doesn't check, the admissions doesn't check whether you've paid your fees or not till the exam time comes. You know, then you have to, you can only sit for it once your fees are all paid up. And then they get stuck.
Yeah, and then they drop out,
exactly,
because they don't have
they
the
have
funds.
Been asked to leave. So this is where we come in. So we interview them, we talk to them. I personally tell them what my vision or my, wish is for them and for me in their lives. And if it matches and blends, then yes, we tell them we will come in and sponsor your education. So we have students from different years, you know, from second year, third year, fourth year, final year. And yes, it continues. And now we work closely with the University of Nairobi. The dean there, Dr. Frederick Ware, he's a professor, of course, of medicine. And he has started shortlisting students now. And we just received a latest request from him to fund a very bright young boy called Alan. And we've just agreed to take him on. So yes, it's nice. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.